भगवान श्री योगी राम सूरत कुमार की जय। सर्वं योगिनां सूरत कुमार अर्पणमस्तु। We owe a deep debt of gratitude to Bhagwan for this great fortune of singing his powerful, auspicious, precious Nama together in his powerful shrine. We know for sure this could be no small grace. Let's offer our salutations, endless salutations, gratefully. Now we have been going through some of his sayings, which are very useful to our sadhana. Let us gallop through some of them. The first one we started with, reducing the desires. The lesser the desire, the lesser will be the expectation. And lesser the expectation, more is the happiness. So let us learn to live with few needs and be contented with it. Bhagwan said, contentment is the greatest virtue, divine virtue. And it is he who is contented in life is the most powerful, rich man. Because he is able to say, I lack nothing in this life. He said, contentment is true happiness. We already have many, many blessings from him. And let us celebrate these blessings and be grateful to Bhagwan so that we get more blessings. And then Bhagwan said, the account that we keep of our life is false account. There is a devata, Chitragupta. There is an invisible cosmic register where a qualified God keeps everybody's account, every creature's account. Starting from the worm, starting from the stone. And that account would be the true account of our lives. So he said, beware. See that you do not harm anybody, even by simplest action or by words. Try to do good to others. If not, at least do not do any harm, either by words or by actions. Knowing that every word that you utter will come back to you one day, be it a good word or bad word. And then Bhagwan said, people pray to this beggar, chant his name, and then when this beggar blesses them and there is a fulfillment of their prayer, they feel so happy, they praise this beggar to the skies and celebrate his grace. But sometimes father does it differently. Sometimes the effect may not be immediate. It may take some time, or it may be negative also. They do not know that everything that this beggar does is a pure blessing. If there is a failure of what they expect, they start abusing this beggar. They do not understand that this very failure is a great blessing for them. That whatever happens, happens only for the greater good of people. And then Bhagavan says, whatever happens in your life or in the world, try to give a high interpretation. The higher the interpretation that you give to any happening, the closer you are to God. And reversely, the closer you are to God, the higher would be your interpretation of things that happen. Which means we have to keep ourselves connected with God so that we get only lofty thoughts. Some people, even somebody says something innocently, would jump to conclusions and misinterpret, twist and turn and create unpleasantness. Well, let them do whatever they like. Bhagavan says, when you do service to the Guru or God, some people would come and praise you, some people would come and abuse you. They may deliberately misinterpret and project you in a bad light, but that should not be your bother. Your job is to be a good instrument in the hands of the Guru or God. This beggar, like Swami Tulsidas, does not bother with praise or abuse. It's enough if this beggar could be a very good instrument in the hands of Sri Rama. And then we shall see one or two glimpses how he interprets, how he comments on certain things. That's why Vishwanathji from Agaram used to visit him at Sanaji State House. And one day, when he found the door of his house locked, he ran to the temple and Bhagavan was seated there on the steps of the Shivaganga tank inside the temple. Bhagavan waved to him, called him, and they were talking. A man came and just sat opposite to Bhagavan. He began to stare at Bhagavan. Now Bhagavan was highly disturbed. He said, you see what is happening? The systematic disturbance some people give to this beggar. This beggar cannot do father's work. They try to put obstacles in the way of father's work. Vishwanathji, let's go out. And then they came out. And on the way, they stopped at a tea shop. He was asking for one Karupaya, well known to him. But Karupaya's son alone was there. And then he gave him a cup of tea for which Bhagavan paid. He gave tea for all the three of them and Bhagavan paid from his pocket. And then he shook the hand of the boy blessed him nicely, and then walked ahead. He stood there looking at the peak of the mountain for some time. He often did. Sometimes when the visitors came, he would point out to the summit of the mountain and say, "Look there. Keep looking." Sometimes he went for an hour or two. Now again that day, he was standing and staring at the peak. Somebody came and said, What is this? What are you looking at?" Bhagwan said, "Ramaswami. This beggar is seeing Ramaswami there," meaning Sri Rama, the divine. And then Bhagavan moved on. They came to a theater, and there was a picture by the name Satya. Satya means truth. When we look at the posters of cinemas, we all know what kind of thoughts would run in our mind. But the minute Bhagwan asked Vishwanathji, "What is written here, Vishwanathji?" "Satyam, Swami." "Oh, Satyam, Ahimsa, Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi ki jai." So a poster with the name Satya, it took him to Mahatma Gandhi. And then we saw some other glimpses yesterday. Now let us shift it to another scene. A man came from Shivakasi and put 36 rupees at the feet of Bhagwan. Bhagwan immediately took it, counted, and it was 36 rupees. Then he said, "Oh, this devotee has given this beggar 36 rupees." At the time, Agaram Jayaraman was near him. He called, "Jayarama, will you please bring a paper and a pen?" Agaram Jayaraman had just come there, and he started to search in his bag for a pen and paper, and it took some time. And Bhagwan said, "What, Jayarama, don't you know this beggar would ask for such things? Don't you know how precious the time of this beggar? This beggar is doing Father's work. Time is precious. You should not make this beggar wait." And of course, finally he got it. And then he wrote this number 36. And then showed it to everybody around. "You see, the number 3, the loose ends of number 3 is outward. The loose ends of number 6, it turned outside." So 3 and 6, when you write, it is like two numbers back to back, turning away from each other. And then he wrote 63. He said, "Now you look at this number. Number 6 is facing number 3, number 3 is facing number 6. Then he said, "You see this 36. When you do the work of the world, when you do some worldly work, you have to turn away from them. Keep your attention away from them and do the work. But when you do Sri Rama's work, just see how 6 He is facing 3 and is very close to 3. And 3 is facing 6 and close to this. These numbers have significance. So number 63 tells you, when you do Father's work, Shri Rama's work, you are facing God all the time and you are very close to God. People were stunned. They had no idea that numbers could mean such things, that there are subtleties to be understood. So when he saw some 36 rupees, somebody submitting to him, he was giving this interpretation. When you do the worldly work, you do it but turn away from it. When you do Shri Rama's work, Father's work, you face God and be close to him and do the work. So you see the interpretations that he always put the highest. Just as Sri Raman Maharishi would say, if anybody came and asked questions, Sri Raman Maharishi would say, would draw their attention to the highest point. Find out who is asking these questions. When you find out, there will be no questions at all. Likewise, Bhagwan always drew the devotee's attention to the lofty truths. So Bhagwan says, always try to put a higher interpretation upon any happening. And be close to God. So let us remember some of these teachings, contemplate on it, and get to the root of it all. That we should not hurt anybody. I remember in Sudama, I've spoken about it before, every day morning 5 o'clock Bhagwan would come and sit there, the veranda, and then he would ask me to go to the garden and pluck 4 flowers and bring. There was a champak tree in front of Sudama. When we planted it, many people said it would not survive 10 days because it's a very hot place. The place is not meant for champak tree. But then, because of Bhagwan's grace, it grew very big and there was plenty of flowers. So every day, I would pluck some flowers from the lower branches. And soon they were all exhausted. And we could find flowers only upon the higher branches. So one day I took the high stool, climbed up, and began to pluck the flowers. Soon Bhagwan was behind me, and he was warning me, Devki, Devki, be very careful. Do not hurt yourself and don't hurt the tree. When he said it with such force and vibration that I just stood there transfixed. For a moment I could not do anything, and what he said sank in me deeply, and suddenly the meaning of it flashed, that whenever we attempt at any work, we must see that we do not hurt anybody in the process, nor should we be hurt by anybody. Meaning, even if anyone abuses you, you don't get hurt. You be careful not to get hurt. And nor should you retort in turn and hurt the others. Because often we find ourselves in situations while in seva, either hurting people or getting hurt. It is so common. So we should remember what Bhagwan says, that when you are in the seva of God or Guru, you should see that you do only good to others. If not, at least do not harm anybody, even by the simplest actions or words. Do not hurt anybody, nor do you allow yourself to be hurt. So let's remember all these things, contemplate on them, and try as much as we can to put it into practice. Let us beg our Bhagwan again and again for the uproot of all the negativities of the mind, all the viruses of the body and the mind. Let us pray to Bhagwan for all those people who are working so hard for the sake of the others, for their protection and all-round welfare. Let us beg again for a boost to our economy, and let us seek His blessings for constant remembrance of His precious name. His name is our wish-fulfilling tree. And Bhagwan had often said, do not forget the Nama. The Nama will begin to run your life. It will do everything for you. In fact, when you chant the name, you don't have to pray separately. Nama is super conscious. Nama knows what is running in your mind. Nama knows your prayers, your feelings. And Nama will do everything for you. Why? Nama is Nami himself. Nama is a supreme consciousness. So it is conscious of everything that you think and do. So let us pray to him again and again for constant, ceaseless remembrance of his name. And let's appeal again and again for his blessings to be good instrument in his hands, not in the instruments in the hands of Maya, so that we could run our everyday life as an offering to him. And finally, let us seek that supreme blessing, the ultimate grace for complete purification of the mind, so that we could see only His presence, His vibrant presence, everywhere, in everything. Only His leelas, in all happenings of life, in all happenings of the world. Let us learn to see, let us prepare our mind to see, even in the worst sufferings of life, His hidden grace, the grace in disguise for our spiritual growth. Let us pray to Him again and again for that eternal living in the eternal entity. Jai Yogiram Sarat Kumar.